constitutes a disaster? Is a disaster winds of 110 miles per hour in search of land? Is it the gyrating of tectonic plates deep within the bowels of the earth? Or perhaps it's a 60-foot wave hurtling at the west coast at 70 miles per hour. We think some disasters could never happen here in St. Lucia, but tornadoes are real and have left lacerations on our neighbor's foreskin. Perhaps the most frequent, unpredictable yet avoidable disasters are man-made. A deranged gunman going postal is as much a disaster as a tsunami. Seasons come, warnings are issued, yet common sense isn't that common until and unless disaster strikes. Now, isn't that an avoidable disaster? A disaster is a sudden calamitous event that seriously disrupts the function of a community or society and causes human, material, and economic or environmental losses that exceeds the community or the country's ability to cope using its own resources. Though often caused by nature, disasters can be of human origin. But there are simple, cost-effective, and common-sense approaches to protect and preserve life and property when disaster strikes. When we are least prepared, disasters can assault us, and few disasters are as unsettling as an earthquake. Every day, the world is jolted by a collection of small earthquakes. Most go unnoticed because they usually occur along the boundaries of the thin plates that cover the earth, like an eggshell. Driven by heat deep beneath the earth's core, the plates grind against each other on long lines called faults. When the plates find their motion blocked, stress builds up, causing faults to give way, and the released energy races through the earth in the form of seismic waves. For much of the world, the movement of plates like these is also an indispensable creative force. Earthquakes have been shaping landscapes for eons. It's only in the last few hundred years that civilizations have gotten in the way. And when they do,
acabou de desmoronar a igreja. Por pouco não cai em cima da gente. Vai do céu.
The seismicity, seismism, or seismic activity of an area refers to the frequency, type, and size of earthquakes experienced over a period of time. Determining the largest earthquakes has been a very difficult task, but here are the top 10. Assam, Tibet, 1950. A magnitude 8.6 earthquake hit, killing 780 people and injuring thousands. The quake struck at the intersection of the most vigorous collision of continental plates on the planet, where the Indian continental plate smashes into the Eurasian plate and dives beneath it. The slow motion crash helped create the massive Himalayas. Number 9. North Sumatra, Indonesia, March 28, 2005. The earthquake lasted about 2 minutes. 1,300 perished. The eighth most powerful earthquake shook the Eskimos on the Rat Islands of Alaska on February 4, 1965. It triggered a tsunami of over 30 feet, yet despite its size, the quake caused little damage due to its remote location at the tip of the Aleutian Islands. No deaths were reported. Ecuador, Colombia. Magnitude 8.8. 1,500 dead. The date? January 31st, 1906. This mega tremble produced a tsunami which spread along the coast of Central America and even stretched to San Francisco and Japan, leaving a wake of death and destruction. Central Chile, February 27th, 2010. Magnitude 8.8, with a shake, rattle, and roll which lasted over 3 minutes. The earthquake triggered a tsunami which devastated several coastal towns and killed over 550 people. It ranks as the sixth largest ever recorded on a seismograph. The world's first recorded magnitude 9.0 tremor when it struck off the coast of Kamchatka, Russia in 1952, generated a 43-foot tsunami. Luckily, there were no casualties. It's etched in recent memory. The videos are all over YouTube as proof. 9.0 on the Richter scale. It struck underwater at a depth of 20 miles. It was the most powerful known earthquake ever to hit Japan. 15,870 dead, 6,140 injured, and 2,814 people are still missing. Nearly 130,000 buildings totally collapsed. Number 3. The Indian Ocean earthquake and accompanying tsunami killed more people than the population of St. Lucia, St. Vincent, and Dominica combined. Christmas holiday, 2004. The epicenter was deep under and off the coast of Sumatra, Indonesia. 98-foot waves inundated coastal communities. This tidal wave was recorded nearly worldwide on the tide gauge in the Indian, Pacific, and Atlantic Ocean. The second largest earthquake occurred on Good Friday, 1964, magnitude 9.2. The shaking lasted about 4 minutes. It was the most powerful earthquake ever recorded in North America. Its accompanying tsunami stole 141 souls. On the afternoon of May 22, 1960, the most powerful earthquake ever recorded in Earth's history rattled Chile. The magnitude 9.5 disaster resulted in a tsunami which affected southern Chile, Hawaii, Japan, the Philippines, New Zealand, and as far as Alaska. 1,655 people were killed and over 2 million rendered homeless. The Caribbean has had its fair share of shake, rattle, and roll as well. 1692, a 7.5 magnitude quake dismantled the city of Port Royal, Jamaica, leaving much of the city submerged underwater and thousands dead. January 11, 1859. St. Lucia got its share with a 7.5 magnitude quake. The epicenter was located east of Martinique, yet in Castries, all public buildings and masonry houses were severely damaged. Sufre was the hardest hit. February 2nd, 1906, a magnitude 7.0 shook Helen to her core. History repeated itself on March 19, 1953. 1990 was an active year for seismic activity in St. Lucia. From February to November, a series of earthquakes ranging from 3.0 to 4.5 had the nation on edge, 7.5 on the charts. November 2007, the earth danced beneath our feet. And just when we thought it was over, the tectonic plates beneath us collided again on December 11, 2007. This time, to the tune of 5.3.
Persons from across the island have been confirming that they did feel it.
Our region should prepare for the big one.
The threat of an impending tectonic rumble is genuine. So much so that regional governments have been airing precautionary public service announcements. Earthquakes cannot be predicted, but there are a few common sense techniques to survive in a quake. Protect your head and face. If you are in a wheelchair when the earthquake begins, lock the wheels. If you are inside, stay inside. If you are outside, stay there. If inside a building, stand in a strong doorway or get under a desk. Avoid elevators. If you are in a vehicle, never stop on or near a bridge. Do not, under any circumstances, stand under or near electric poles or close to a building from which debris may fall. If you are in a store, move away from display shelves containing bottles. After the earthquake, be prepared for aftershocks. Check for fires and shut off utilities if necessary. Turn on the transistor radio for emergency bulletins and stay away from landslide-prone areas.
This is from our camera reporter in Miyagi. And it looks like the tsunami has engulfed several cities.
Tsunamis are byproducts of earthquakes. History has recorded that if the earthquake doesn't drown you, the accompanying tsunami will. And because it has not happened in our lifetime, doesn't mean that it will never. A tsunami has washed out the Virgin Islands in the past. Puerto Rico, Guadeloupe, Antigua, Bekwe, Grenada have all felt the slapping of the waves and financial ruin due to tidal surge. We are surrounded by water, and a rogue wave can bring death to our shores. But here's a common sense guide to tsunami safety. When in coastal areas, stay alert for tsunami warnings. Plan an evacuation route that leads to higher ground. Know the warning signs of a tsunami, rapidly rising and falling coastal waters, and the rumbling of an offshore earthquake. Never stay near the shore to watch the tsunami come in. A tsunami is a series of waves. Do not return to an affected coastal area until authorities have given the all clear. Coming up, what would you do if a gunman enters your building and starts shooting? One of the swiftest, most destructive disasters is fire. A fire can engulf a structure in minutes. Understanding the basic characteristics of fire and learning the proper safety practices can be the key to surviving a burning building. On average, in St. Lucia, there are 7,400 ambulance calls and 630 fire calls annually. Most children are fascinated with fire, and that curiosity sometimes costs them their lives. Every child should be taught that matches and lighters are tools, not toys. Every family should develop and practice an escape plan. Install smoke detectors, check them once a month, and change the batteries at least once a year. Practice evacuating your workplace blindfolded. In a real fire situation, the amount of smoke generated by the fire will most likely make it impossible to see. Learn to stop, drop, and roll if clothes catch fire.
Aurora, Colorado. Inside Century 16's Theater 9, it was chaos.
Mass shootings have tripled in the USA between 2000 and 2008. Mass murder is the act of killing many people simultaneously over a relatively short period of time. It typically occurs in a single location, with the perpetrator dying by suicide, or suicide by cop. October 16th, 1991. George Hennard crashed his pickup through a glass window of the Libby's cafeteria in Texas. "This is what Bell County did to me. This is payback," he shouted, and killed 23 people and wounded 20 others before committing suicide. The majority of his victims were women. During the shooting, he shouted, "All women of Kayleen Belton are vipers." If you think a sick scenario like that could never happen on St. Lucian soil, think again. Remember the Cathedral Massacre on January 1st, 2001? Here are some helpful tips in the event this bizarre situation should reoccur. Decide if you will run or hide. Runners have a higher survival rate than people who hide. Run in a zigzag motion. Forget your personal belongings. Bring people with you. Cover your tracks if you can. The second method is hiding and barricading yourself. Once you are behind the closed door, immediately switch off the light. Place heavy furniture behind the door. If possible to do so, once inside, stay as low down as you can. Look around for objects which may be used as weapons. And if your location is compromised, remember, attacking the shooter is your final option. Do not try to reason with the shooter or plead for your life. Studies have shown that trying to negotiate with the shooter or plead for your life have not been proven effective in preventing such mass casualties. The shooter will be on a rampage and will most often not be inclined to any reasoning. So don't waste your time by trying to talk to him. You will be better off fighting. Sometimes the worst killers and most destructive disasters are the ones we don't even see coming. August 1841, yellow fever killed 9. March 1849, civil unrest killed 8. Today, chikungunya is the newest malady. But when cholera was on the lips of St. Lucians between July and October 1854, it killed 1,500 people on the island, the majority of whom were from Sufre. Disaster came in the form of fire on May 14th and 15th, 1927, when 17 blocks were burned flat in Castries. Human error caused the death of 41 people when the MV George, a ferry vessel, overturned near Sufre on February 24, 1935. History was cruel to the residents of the South, and it happened again. February 13, 1937. The May Rose sank off the coast of Choiseul. 12 people drowned. The history books recorded a muddy disaster on November 21st and 22nd, 1938, dubbed Black Friday. 100 people perished. June 19th and 20th, 1948, the city of Castries went up in flames. When the smoke cleared, 2,300 people had nowhere to live.
Around 8 o'clock the night, where I was living was a place named Mondino. And I can remember him, "Hey, me vi la pudife, me vi la pudife." When I did look, I see the fire. I hearing people up and down the road saying, "Kote Adonis di fi apwi." Kote Adonis, this Adonis was a tailor fella. That was in Victoria Street.
I ran down Victoria Street because the fire brigade station, Castries Fire Brigade Station, was down Victoria Street. I ran down there. When I got there, I saw some brigades playing dominoes. So I shouted to them. I said, "Come, there's a big fire up the road and you're all down here playing dominoes." Anyway, they got up and they got together. See, in those days, you only had a cart and your fire hoses. I mean, there was no form of mechanical transport.
We were a very divided society. Class was imminent. The question of the class structure was well established. But that night, I saw people, the aristocracy, running around town in their 90s to get away from the fire. And they were very glad to help the people that they probably snubbed to assist them.
Because some people took things here, took things there. They loaded the trucks, whether it was their truck or not.
I hear people say there was a pigeon carrying this fire from one to the next. I will not see as much, because I did not see any pigeon. What I will see, when a rum shop catch a fire, the heat, the bottles, when they will burst, when it is spirit in there, when it bursts out and the pieces going out, it going out in flames and it catching another place. But some of the people say it was a pigeon flying, bringing fire from one place to the next. I cannot say as much.
I saw a white bird flying up in the air, say by the presbytery. So when I look all the time, I see the fire now take over the church, the Catholic Church. When it take over the Catholic Church, it went and it rests a little by Montplaisir after the Catholic Church. It left by Montplaisir building. It didn't stay long. The fire take a little there. And then now the fire went right away down, going down by Beggars, the bird. Wherever the bird fly, the fire catch.
Half of the town were wiped out, what you see, on the middle part and the western. But northern side, but the western side is a bad, the square side, nothing touched there. Yeah. That's all I can remember, of course. And everybody was down and out.
June 9th, 1955. Soufre got its share. Three people were killed and 2,000 were displaced. Compromised structural integrity caused the upper floor of the Teachers' Training College to collapse on March 23rd, 1972. 250 people were affected by this perplexing disaster. An oil spill is perhaps one of the greatest threats to every single industry in St. Lucia. And with ships carrying millions of barrels crisscrossing our shores every day, disaster can strike at any time. October 19th, the MV Flinders released 93 barrels of Arabian light crude oil in the cul-de-sac bay. The oil belonged to Mobil Oil. The oil spread from the Hess Oil compound at cul-de-sac to the north of the island. Funny enough, disasters can also occur when people stop talking. June 5th, 1998, the entire telephone system collapsed. Payphones, normal phones, fax, internet, and emergency numbers were disconnected. And on May 18th, 19th, and 20th, 2002, it happened again. November 6, 2004, Lucilec had its own meltdown. The entire island went black. August 19, 2007, it happened again. When we return, the most consistent threat to St. Lucia.
For those of us who have sat back and analyzed the situation, if we are honest with ourselves, we will recognize that had we paid more attention to the weather report on the night of Friday, September 9th, then we would not have been caught completely off guard.
And late this afternoon, we had some high clouds ahead of the system coming in. So you can see here, this is Barbados here, this is St. Lucia here, and you can see the cloud mass is very intense. Just east of the Lesser Antilles here is the area of deepest convection. This is where you have the most showers and thunder showers. So we expect as the system moves towards the west, move over the islands, we will see an increase in cloudiness, showers, some gusty winds.
Animals possess a sixth sense which triggers flight when impending danger looms. Some migrate, others move to higher ground. Human beings, the smartest animals on the planet, instinctively disregard the forces of nature, but always expect a different result. Weather systems are yearly phenomena, with misses and hits. It is imperative we know what they are and how to prepare for them. A trough is defined as a large-scale anti-clockwise turning of the wind associated with a low-pressure system. Many exist as an elongated extension from the low-pressure center or without any connection to a low-pressure center. Floods are one of the most common natural disasters, but they are also some of the most destructive and deadly. It only takes 15 centimeters of water to knock a human down, and 60 centimeters can move a car. Floods occur when excess water has nowhere to go. They're worse when the area doesn't have proper drains, but even advanced stormwater systems can be overwhelmed by a deluge in a short amount of time. Regions that are recovering from drought are even less able to cope with massive rain, even though it is just what they need. The ground is too dry to absorb the water. While floods can damage buildings and roads, cause blackouts and destroy crops, one of the biggest dangers they pose is the spread of disease. Not only can floodwaters disrupt water supply, but none of these milliliters can be drunk. Dirty water and a lack of sanitation can lead to the rapid spread of influenza, gastro or meningitis, as well as potentially fatal outbreaks of cholera. Large pools of stagnation are also the perfect breeding ground for mosquitoes that can pose yet another health threat. When a flood warning is issued, be sure to store drinking water in as many containers as possible. If you are living in a low-lying area, put sandbags and other protection in place. Remove electrical items from the floor, and remember, never touch electrical equipment if you are standing in water. After the flood, do not visit disaster areas uselessly. Your presence might hamper rescue operations. Floodwaters may have swollen doors tightly shut, so use windows and other openings. Flash flooding can occur within several seconds to several hours with little warning. Rainfall intensity, rainfall duration, surface conditions, topography, and the slope of the receiving basin all contribute to flash flooding. Tropical waves, easterly waves, or tropical easterly waves, also known as African easterly waves in the Atlantic region, are a type of atmospheric trough, an elongated area of relatively low air pressure, oriented north to south, which moves from east to west across the tropics, causing areas of cloudiness and thunderstorms. A tropical depression, on the other hand, is formed over open seas and is characterized by extreme wind damage, intense downpour, tidal surge accompanied by a melody of lightning and thunder. A tropical depression breezes along between 39 and 73 miles per hour and gives birth to the devil's baby brother, the tropical storm.
When our cameras got out on the road about 8:30 this morning, the water levels had dropped significantly, but there was still more water to be seen on the streets of the city than any of the crew could recall for quite some time. Hardly any area appeared to have been spared by the flooding. The John Compton Highway at its junctions of Chabatis Street and Jeremy Street itself, Wood Street, the Boulevard, Pioneer Street between the Town Hall and Jeremy Street, Coral Street from its junction with High Street all the way to Jeremy Street, Monjuro Street, Manuel Street, and Foreshore were all underwater. One of the areas most severely affected was the village of Anslaway. A number of houses were washed away and at least one person is reported to have drowned.
The rain fell over 3 hours. By the time I woke up, I step in water. And by the time I catch myself to just put on my clothes and everything to get up, everywhere was flooded. The water was giving me about that length, about my shoulder length. All around, eh? But in my house, the water was about my breast height there. You know? And so much water. That's the first time. I'm 33 years, I'll be 32 years, and that's the first time in my life I ever see water like that.
But the flooding was not all. The heavy rains also caused damage to the roads, electricity and telecommunications networks, as well as bridges and other infrastructure.
The community of Piai was further isolated when a bridge leading to this area failed to withstand the force of the running water and was carried along. Several residents spoke of narrow escapes and loss of property, but there were no reports of casualties or serious injuries. The central part of the island appeared to be the hardest hit. The more than 12 landslides on the Bad Nil made it impassable for vehicles.
Further evidence of the severity of the floods, this vehicle was washed away some 300 yards into the sea along the west coast. The distraught owner had almost given up hope.
We had some fellas leaving. It was about 300 yards, 400 yards out in the sea. There were some fellas swimming out there and they happened to see it. I had some fellas diving early on, but then the water was not clear and they couldn't trace it.
The town crier was used to disseminate information considering the lack of communication in certain areas.
This is an act of God. There's nothing we can do except to do our best.
But this certainly was not the worst. The history books relay the events of the great 1780 hurricane, which killed 23,200 people in the Caribbean. It packed winds of over 200 miles per hour. It stripped the bark off trees. The waves and storm surge struck the British fleet of Admiral Rodney at Port Castries. The hurricane lifted one of the ships and deposited it on top of the Castries Hospital. This twister destroyed all but two houses in Castries. Every bridge on the island collapsed, and over 6,000 St. Lucians were killed. To date, the Great 1780 Hurricane remains the most powerful in history. Other tropical cyclones have left us wet over the years. August 11th, 1931, 11 killed. February 7th, 1911, not even during the official hurricane season, 11 residents were killed again by freak weather. July 10th, 1960, Hurricane Abby kills 6 and leaves us in $4 million worth of expense. In August 1980, Alan Luisi was our Prime Minister, and the turbulence of his government, the gloomy forecast of the economy, was muddled when a nasty hurricane, coincidentally called Alan, blasted and left a trail of destruction on the island. ...6,000 St. Lucians were homeless on the morning of August 4th.
A
A front-end loader makes its way through the devastated west coast town of Soufrière, carrying evidence of part of the toll in human lives. Three dead bodies from what is being described as the worst natural disaster ever to hit St. Lucia. Hurricane Thomas, which launched a broad daylight assault on St. Lucia starting Saturday, 30th October 2010. At that time, Thomas was not yet a hurricane, and its winds were merely toying with the island of St. Lucia. But the play soon got rough. The seas began to rage and foam, whipped into a fury by the wind, an early indication that Thomas would make a name for itself in the annals of notoriety of local disasters, alongside infamous names like Alan, Debbie, and Lenny. The fishing village of Dennery, still recovering from massive flooding associated with heavy rainfall a few weeks earlier, saw the possibility of history repeating itself and began to prepare.
Well, so far we've experienced some high winds, rough seas, and there's been some intense rain as well.
Even in the early stages, when Thomas was just a tropical storm, it was ripping roofs off houses and causing flooding in Dennery. The Dennery Hospital was abandoned by patients and staff as water flooded the institution and strong winds ripped off part of the hospital's roof. For those who doubted, Thomas would give them a wake-up call. Along the Bar de Lille, even before Thomas was upgraded to a hurricane, a preview of what was to come was very much in evidence. A landslide that brought trees crashing down on a minibus that had its forward movement hindered by debris that blocked the road. A woman in the parked vehicle ran for her life, while the driver bemoaned the loss of the vehicle, even as he recognized that he had retained something of greater and excelling value. Thomas, which eventually became a Category 1 hurricane, at times seemed to play cat and mouse with terror-stricken St. Lucians, appearing to be at the end of its devastating rampage through the island, then suddenly changing its mind and renewing its assault with greater intensity. The barrage continued for some 8 hours, until finally, Thomas's rage had been spent.
A mother and two sons, they died and two grown men missing. They disappeared in their houses. But we covered the mother and the two sons and we put them by the road waiting for the more emergency to come up.
This place, it is a disaster, you know. There's nothing you could say about this.
The worst that I have seen in my entire life. It's worse than Allen, it's worse than Debbie, it's worse than Lenny.
Vehicles lay submerged under heavy mud, and fishermen counted their losses in terms of damage or missing boats. Aerial footage would merely serve to confirm the scale of the disaster, from damaged airport fences at Huanora International Airport to flooding at cul-de-sac at the Hess Oil Refinery. St. Lucia had become a disaster zone, but the effect of Hurricane Thomas was by no means limited to Soufrière. There was hardly a part of the island that was not spared.
I cannot find adequate words to describe what I've seen.
We have been devastated by a hurricane, in my view, which tantamounts to a combination of Debbie and Allen.
December 25th is a day of festive thanksgiving for most. But tears, mud, destruction and expense was the present that awaited St. Lucians on Christmas morning, 2013. The devastation was astonishing. The damage ran in the hundreds of millions, and the scars left by this nameless weather system are still lacerated all over Helen's beautiful face. Sadly, many of the people who have lost their lives, limbs, and their property were the ones who were least prepared. When we return, we present the Common Sense Guide to Hurricane Preparedness. The word hurricane comes from the Tiano or Arawak native word hurrican, meaning evil spirit of the wind. 1943 was the first time anyone flew into a hurricane, in the middle of World War II. In 1944, the US Navy's Pacific Fleet was crushed by Typhoon Cobra, which sank three destroyers and damaged many ships. Hurricanes are the only weather disasters that have been given their own names. Hurricanes didn't start having boy names until 1979. When a hurricane is especially devastating, its name is permanently retired and another name replaces it. Bangladesh was a country that was created from a hurricane. In 1970, this region of Pakistan was struck by a cyclone and 500,000 people died. The people felt their government did not do enough to help after the disaster. So, in 1971, they voted to be independent of Pakistan and Bangladesh was born. In the 1950s and 60s, people went to hurricane parties with the partygoers to watch hurricanes rather than flee from danger. There were claims that in 1969, Hurricane Camille wrecked a hotel where a hurricane party was being held and killed 8 people. Every second, a large hurricane releases the energy of 10 atomic bombs. The planet Jupiter has a hurricane which has been going on for over 300 years. It can be seen as a red spot on the planet. This hurricane on Jupiter is bigger than Earth itself. Plants have developed different ways of protecting themselves from powerful winds. Palm trees grow mainly in tropical parts of the world where hurricanes sometimes occur. Their flexible trunks bend and spring back in high winds, but rarely break. Taping your windows in preparation for a hurricane is a waste of time and money. Tape does not strengthen the glass. Flying debris will smash the taped window as if the tape was never there. Storms are Mother Nature's way of cleansing. There is nothing we can do to redirect a melodious fury, but the most proactive thing we can do is to insure against it. Choosing the right insurance policy is crucial. Many homeowners learn the hard way, or the wet way, that their homeowner's insurance does not cover damage caused by hurricanes or floods. The second and most important preparedness strategy is the disaster kit. It should contain at least the following items: medicines, non-perishable foods, torchlight and batteries, cell phones and chargers, a first aid kit, insurance papers, passport and ID cards, car keys, Ziploc bags, and cash and credit cards. Everyone in the household must know its location. Do not leave animals tied. Ensure that there is a clear plan to deal with anyone within the household with a disability. Implement a buddy system with neighbors or friends. Do not rely on one person. Teach your children how to call for help. Also, ensure that emergency numbers are near the telephone. St. Lucia has no hurricane shelters, so remember, places of worship are shelters for everyone and not for the congregation only. Also remember, your pets are not allowed at the shelter. Never use candles or have any open flame while the wind is blowing. Stay away from unprotected windows. Don't give in to temptation to see what's happening through it. Do not go filming in the hurricane. If power blinks off and on, turn off all the circuit breakers except the one that powers a lamp in an internal part of your house. Flash flooding may still occur even if it's not raining hard in your community. Homes near streams face the greatest threats. All coastlines are vulnerable to dangerous surf that can threaten lives and property. Do not go near the water. Use extreme caution when driving along shoreline roads, especially at night. High surf may be strong enough to wash away vehicles off the road. We live in the midst of unpredictable man-made disasters and sporadic natural catastrophes. Anxiety beclouds the future. We expect a new disaster with each newspaper we read. We can avoid being part of the collateral damage left by man and nature if we all adopt a common sense approach to disaster preparedness. Raise your voice, not the sea level. Do we really understand what this means for tomorrow's generation? Some natural disasters are unavoidable, and they are nature's way of continuous evolution. However, the majority of natural hazards are impregnated with greater destructive power due to man's caustic ways. We know enough about climate change. Now, it is time for action. Coping with climate change, what does that mean? Climate has always determined how we live, and when it changed in the past, we adapted. So what's new about adapting to climate change today? Shouldn't we focus on other challenges such as education, unemployment, and economic development? Sure enough, the climate has always been changing, but the recent change caused by emission of gases such as carbon dioxide, methane, that increased the greenhouse effect of the atmosphere has happened in a much shorter time frame. As a result, the Earth is warming. This change in our climate is already leading to significant impacts. Glaciers are melting faster than expected. Sea level is on the rise, and it is very likely that droughts and extreme weather events like hurricanes will become more frequent. These impacts destroy livelihoods and homes. They damage our infrastructure and disrupt communication and trade. Moreover, climate change is endangering developmental successes, and the poor and the marginalized are often affected the most. Okay, climate change is evidently taking place. Whether it accelerates further depends on our lifestyle and economic activities. So, is it all about reducing carbon emissions? Well, even if we were to stop emissions instantly, the world would not stop warming immediately due to the amount of gases we have already emitted. That's why we must do both. Reduce greenhouse gas emissions and adapt to inevitable climate change. But how exactly can we adapt, considering the precise extent and form of climate change aren't known? Climate projections will never be able to predict the future with absolute certainty, partly because the way in which the climate will change depends on our decisions in coming years. But do we really need certainty to make decisions? No. We routinely make decisions based on experience, fact, or insights available to us without knowing exactly what the future will bring. And while we don't know everything about future climate change, we know enough to act. But what exactly do we need to do differently? Basically, we need to bear in mind both current and future impacts of climate change. Climate projections do not translate into concrete strategies, but they can serve as guardrails for planning. We should consider how developmental plans, policies, and projects might be affected by climate change, and to what extent these in turn make climate change worse. One possible consequence of climate change is precipitation pattern changes. These may lead to both drought and extreme rain, sometimes in the same place. We should ask ourselves how a land use plan must be changed in order to remain flexible in reacting to future challenges. What adaptation measures can help minimize the effect on the local economy and people's livelihoods? Coastal megacities worldwide are threatened by the adverse consequences of sea level rise and extreme weather events. But what does an urban planner need to consider in order to make these cities climate resilient? What are the most suitable adaptation options? Clear criteria like urgency, cost, political and social acceptance can help to prioritize adaptation options such as flood preparedness measures, improvement of drainage systems, wetland restoration, and coastal management. Adaptation is a learning process. We all need to continuously improve our adaptation strategies, and making climate change adaptation a topic at all levels is important. We need to reduce greenhouse emissions and adapt to the impact of climate change. And we must start acting today. Together, involve decision makers, increase understanding about climate change, and create awareness for the need for society to adapt. These are important first steps. Preparing for possible things to come is much better than bearing the impacts of climate change without any protection. We know enough. Let's adapt. Let's rally, rethink, and respond together.
The fool has never been told.